Tonight's event is about a huge word. The word is exoneration, and what exoneration means is the official turning of the justice system 180 degrees from guilty to not guilty. And this doesn't happen very often. The joke, the cynical joke, is that the jails are full of innocent people. All you have to do is ask these guys in jail. Well, in recent years, several universities have taken on the project of investigating questionable convictions. And what we know now is that there are 1,408 people who have been exonerated since 1989 in the U.S. People who were serving time in prison for crimes they did not commit. People who were wrongly convicted. 92% of them are men. 46% of them were falsely convicted of homicide. Mr. Glisson's case falls right square in the middle of these numbers. On average, these people serve 9 years. Eric served 18. He was in prison when you were born without hope of getting out. In homicide cases, the rate of official misconduct, which is to say that the prosecution and the detectives mishandled the case, the rate of official misconduct is quite high, 59% in homicide cases that have been exonerated. It's often said that eyewitness misidentification is the most common cause of false convictions. This is a misconception because when the exoneration program really got to work, it was on rape cases where DNA was the important piece of evidence. But as more and more of these cases have been processed, we're finding that perjury and false accusation are more than half of the time the case in an exoneration case. So I just wanted to lay that context before you, before we get started tonight. Here with you tonight is the Stony Brook USG president, two terms. Which years were you?
90 and 91.
Dan Slepian was sitting where you're sitting. He was a student at Stony Brook. He was a USG president. He's gone on to a terrific career at NBC as a producer. And tonight, he's going to lead us through this complex and interesting story. Dan, welcome home.
Thank you. Speaking about those of you who are young, I'm used to the roving mic. I started my career working for a guy named Phil Donahue, who was a talk show host before Oprah. So he's the one that put the mic in your mouth, so you move around a lot. Tonight, thank you for having us. I'm really excited about being here because I think that you're going to really enjoy meeting Eric and hearing this story. Tonight, you're going to hear about Eric Glisson, this photo that I took when he was still locked in his cell in Sing Sing, 18 years, nearly two decades for a crime that he didn't commit, a murder he had nothing to do with, completely exonerated. Professor Miller, and I know what he meant, said, goes from guilty to not guilty. Eric was actually innocent. And that there is a legal definition, right? Not guilty doesn't mean you're actually innocent. Eric was not guilty and he was actually innocent. But what's remarkable about Eric is he's a remarkable human being. And you're going to see why. Because basically, he got himself out of prison through a lot of the tools that you guys are actually learning here at Stony Brook. Freedom of information requests, perseverance, a fight, never giving up, fighting for the truth. But before we get to Eric's case, very quickly, how we got here and how I got here. When I graduated Stony Brook, as I said, I went on to work at the Donahue Show, and then I've been working as a producer with Dateline NBC. This is my 19th year at Dateline, actually. And more than a decade ago, I had done a story about a murder at the Palladium nightclub in New York City that two innocent men were convicted for a crime they didn't commit. Very complicated story. I was here talking about this about 6 or 7 years ago. That was a two-hour broadcast documentary that NBC aired on in 2007. I had been filming that for 5 years. When I came to my own moral certainty that these two men were actually innocent, their names were David Lemus and Almedo Hidalgo, I used to go visit Mr. Lemus in prison on the anniversary for the murder for which he was wrongfully convicted. It was Thanksgiving Day is when I used to go visit him. And I was visiting him, and they ultimately got out of prison, conviction was overturned, they're free. In 2002, I was visiting Mr. Lemus on Thanksgiving Day, and I said to him, you know, you must meet other guys in prison. If there's anybody else you think I should talk to, let me know. And by this time, as a journalist, you know, when you're working your way through your careers in life, all of us have our passions, all of us have our interests. For me, it was like a light bulb that went off at some point. I was sitting across the table in a maximum security prison, and I had evidence that this man was actually innocent. He had been there for 15 years, and nobody was really doing anything about it. So I used to visit him and ask, and I started asking about other cases. He said to me, you know, there's this guy I met in the legal library. His name is John Adrian Velasquez. I said, have John Adrian write to me. John Adrian wrote to me on December 5th, 2002. And his letters were so desperate and yearning for help, proclaiming his innocence in the face of such obvious potential innocence and evidence. I spent 10 years investigating that case. In 2012, that aired with, it was Tim Russert's son, Luke Russert. It was his first primetime hour. That aired in 2012. It was nominated for 3 Emmys and won none, but that's okay. They say it's nice being nominated. It's not true at all. It's good to win. But in 2012, I was visiting John Adrian in the spring of 2012, and he said to me, you got to go see this guy, Eric Glisson. He's got quite a story. And the headline was that Eric was one of six human beings to be wrongfully convicted of the murder of a cab driver in the Bronx in 1995. And that when I learned about Eric's case, a federal investigator had just shown up recently to say, we know you're innocent because we knew who the killers were 10 years ago. They actually pled guilty in the federal system. We asked the NYPD about it, but the NYPD told us the murder never existed. So 10 years go by. He was convicted in 95 with 6 other people. In 2002, two guys confess in the federal government, and the federal government goes to the NYPD, and they're told the murder did not exist. So at that point, 8 people were in prison for a murder that 2 people committed. 10 years go by. In 2012, Eric, who had been fighting for a decade, never giving up. You look up tenacious in the dictionary, it should be, Eric Glisson should be, Eric Glisson and tenacious should be the definition. Never giving up. Filing freedom of information requests, seeking information, always being denied, believing in his innocence, investigating the case from behind bars in his prison cell. And in 2012, he finally gets a freedom of information request back. And it's the cell phone records from a stolen cell phone from the cab driver, the victim, from 1995. And Eric, from his prison cell, figures out that more dozens and dozens of calls were made after the victim's death, including one 3 minutes after his death. Eric, from his prison cell, finds out that the numbers called are 2 gang members that went down in a federal case. And he writes a letter smack into the middle of federal bureaucracy of law enforcement. Dear U.S. Attorney, my name is Eric Glisson and I'm innocent and so are 5 other people. Miraculously, that letter landed on the desk of the investigator in the U.S. Attorney's office in the Southern District of New York, a guy by the name of John O'Malley. Miraculously, he was the guy who got those confessions 10 years earlier from those other 2 guys. And he reads the letter and he says, holy crap, those guys confessed to me 10 years ago. He drives up to Sing Sing. He sees Eric and he says, I'm sorry, we didn't know you were here. But that wasn't the end of Eric's story. I started filming around there. You'll see Eric in prison in a minute. I'm going to show you some clips to get you familiar with this story, and then you'll meet him. But that wasn't it, because even after that, the system, and we'll talk about this later, I'm sure, but the bureaucracy that is law, that is the criminal justice system, took another 6 or 7 months to get him out. And when he did get out, and everybody else, they still didn't admit they were wrong and made him wear an ankle bracelet for 3 months. But when we sought out, started out telling Eric's story, we didn't know where it was going to go. We didn't know if he was going to get out. I didn't know if he was innocent. But what I did know is that he was a special human being who communicated in a way sometimes that's more than just words. And he had the facts to back him up. And so what we did is we figured out, I went to deconstruct Eric's story and meet some people along the way. So this first clip I'm going to show you, this was an hour-long broadcast that aired that I've cut down, don't worry, to three clips of just a few minutes. And the first clip is how we started the show, and you'll meet a woman that was an odd... Has anybody in here seen the show, by the way, just by show of hands? All right, good. A few... Oh, too many. Okay. So you'll relive it again. So the first clip is a very unlikely friend of Eric's, as you'll see, who got him in some ways to where we are today. Professor Miller was telling you about eyewitness identification. It is, frankly, a really unreliable form of evidence. People think that you see a shooting, somebody comes and shoots you, or shoots somebody you're standing next to, you have an indelible image etched into your memory. Study after study have shown that's actually not true. And the only thing that inculpated Eric and the others, which means the only evidence against Eric, was an eyewitness who was a drug-addicted homeless prostitute who, 2 weeks after the crime, the day of the crime, a 911 call comes in, says a guy saw what happened. He calls 911. He says, I saw one or two men, black men, running away. No one really ever comes to talk to that witness again, the guy who called 911. But 2 weeks later, a woman comes forward. And she says, I know some guys in the neighborhood who did this. And she names six people. And that's it. But worse, she couldn't possibly have seen what she said she saw. And worse, the detectives never checked out if she could see what she said she saw, as you'll see right here. The lead detective in the case who arrested Eric, he was responsible for this whole thing. He never did that. He never went into the apartment to see if she could say what she saw. Six people. And it got past the prosecutor, got past the detectives, lieutenants, got past jury, appellate courts. It's that simple. There's really nothing more to it because you're thinking, well, wait, I don't get it. That's what happened. So Eric is fighting from behind bars and will never give up. This is 95, we didn't shoot this in 95, but this happened, this murder in 95. So as I said, in 2012, he finally gets this paperwork that launches him ultimately into his freedom. And while he's in his cell, he's trying to keep up his hope. He's trying to keep up any sort of semblance of hope in the face of other people really not being, I mean, you remember Professor Miller said there was just over 1,000 people since the 80s exonerated. Think of any bureaucracy in the world. You know it doesn't work 100% of the time. The DMV, government, doesn't work 100% of the time. We're human beings. There's 2 million people in prison in America. If 1% is actually innocent, what is that, 20,000 people or something? If 5%, I happen to think it's a little bit higher. So since the 80s, we've exonerated over 1,000 people. If it works 95% of the time, it's a pretty good system. If 5% are actually innocent, it's 100,000 people in prison today. It's an epidemic in my view. So Eric tries to keep his hope in prison, and ultimately, and I'm whizzing past obviously a lot of the details because there's some nuance here, but ultimately he gets out. So you're going to see, you could let this play to the end, and you can move that cursor off that bar because that's really annoying. But you'll see at the end, this is Eric in his cell and what keeps him going and what he hopes for. And then and you're going to see a 6 minute, the end of the hour, which is the first day and the first year of Eric's release as a free man after 18 years, nearly two decades in prison.
Thank you, everyone. You know, this is actually my second time seeing this. I seen it the first time it aired, and I never watched it again because it brings tears to my eyes. And I just want to thank everyone for showing up and showing interest in this story and, you know, giving me an audience to present, you know, what happened to me and show you that there is injustice in this world and that you, as up-and-coming students and people who are going to be in a journalist career, will have an opportunity to change some of that by exposing these things and being aware of them and, you know, carrying on my fight. And I just want to thank you for that. A lot of you may not know about the criminal justice system and how it functions, but there's a lot of flaws in it, and it pains me that us as a country, a nation of law and order that we project around the world, has serious flaws in our justice system, and something needs to be done. And so I'm petitioning every one of you that if you ever hear of something that's an injustice in this world, regardless if it's related to you or just a total stranger, help that person. Stand up and help them, because I never thought that anybody would help me. I thought I was in there alone by myself, but Grandma, she introduced me to Mr. Cross, my attorney, and they stood by me for nearly 7 years while I had this long, protracted fight against the Bronx District Attorney's Office. And we prevailed. And I'm standing here in front of you today, you know, no longer the victim, like I said, but the victor. And, you know, it feels great to be in society, because at first I thought that I would be rejected, that I spent so many years away from society that I would never be able to fully reacclimate back into society. It was a trial. You know, I know that I had to do a lot of empirical observations just to like readjust and look at the different subcultures, the societal norms and things of that nature. But I did it, and I think I'm kind of successful that I came out of here, out of prison, not unscathed, but somewhat intact. And with that, I would like to know if anyone has any questions.
Have you met
officers that arrested you? No. Basically, right now they're secluding themselves because there's you know, major legal matters, you know, that's involved with the case right now in terms of civil matters. Do I sit down?
Brother, you can do whatever you want to do. You're free.
Yeah, you're a free man. Have a seat.
How do they turn this
off? Don't worry about that one. Just put it on the ground and they'll take care of it. So I have to do this because I have kids and because I'm a professor. Why was getting a diploma the first thing you needed to do?
Well, you know, I dropped out of school in sixth grade. I wanted to hang out with my friends. You know, I wanted to be, you know, part of the group. You know, a lot of peer pressure. I just wanted to be a likable person. And I've always found myself wanting to please others. And so I dropped out of school in sixth grade, and I hung out with my friends, and I actually never went back. So while I was in prison, I didn't have a GED, I didn't have anything, a high school diploma or anything. But I knew I had to get it. I knew in there I had to change my life, and I had to bring a different man home to my family. Not the same one who left them. So I made a promise to myself that I was gonna get my GED. And I immediately went to the education counselor, and I got some self-study materials from her. And I told her I wanted to take my GED, but she was reluctant to give it to me because she said, you only went to the sixth grade, and you might as well just not even take your GED. But I told her I'm going to take this GED and I'm going to pass it. And so she gave me the self-study, and I stood in almost every day, didn't go for recreation or anything, and I passed it on my first try. And after that, immediately after that, they had college, Mercy College, in there, where the professors would teach in the daytime on a campus and then come and give classes at night. And I wanted to get into the Mercy College program. And so I decided to apply for it. I went through hell trying to get in there because you have to take an entry-level exam and you have to do remedial classes and things like that. But I was determined, and I went to the library. I got a lot of books. I studied the dictionary. I would take 5 words out of the dictionary a day to build up my vocabulary so that I can express myself better and write better, because Mercy College are very big on writing. And I passed the entry-level exam, and I was admitted. Fortunately, 2 days after I got out, I was released from prison. I was back on the campus in the same professor's classes that I was in there, biology, English, Spanish. But I had 9 classes left to complete my degree, my bachelor's. I was doing a bachelor's in behavioral science, psychology. I wrote a letter, me and my attorney with his assistant, we wrote letters to the president of the college and asked, practically begged her if I could take these 9 classes along with some, what did they call those? Life experience courses. And it was granted to me, and I did the classes, and I graduated 6 months after I was released from prison with a bachelor's degree. So I've taught myself because I was my main critic. I always thought that I couldn't do it. But once I got that taste that I could, there was no stopping me. I just went full head, and I knew that one day I would be released from prison. If I stayed the course and I didn't give up. Because once you give up, it's like nailing a nail in your coffin. You might as well roll over and die. But I die on my feet, not on my knees. So any of you, whatever you may be going through in life, whatever trial or tribulation, just don't give up. Don't give up. Fight to the end. Because the next day is always a new day for victory. So please, don't give in to pressure. Don't give in to anything. If you believe in your heart that what you're doing is the right thing, just go for it.
Peter, this is not your line of work. you're a corporate lawyer. You're the guy who deals with the people who get away with it.
No, I don't.
I mean, maybe you felt that way at times.
No,
you
know, I haven't felt that way.
But with people you're dealing with, when you're representing somebody, I mean, you're in this tension-filled environment in which there are counterclaims between your client and maybe another person's client. What was so compelling about Eric that you took his case? What had he done that made the case make sense to you?
Well, the whole reason I got involved in this case really was Sister Joanna Chan. Sister Chan and I go back years. She's an amazing woman, as Eric will yes. tell you. And when she came here from China as a Maronal nun, she started teaching. She enrolled in Columbia University, got a doctorate in education there. And she founded a small theater company in Manhattan called the Yangtze Repertory Theater. And I ended up representing her pro bono in that theater project, and we got to be good friends. And so when she got to know Eric from the Sing Sing theater program and started to believe in his innocence, and she got me involved to meet Eric in the first place, and I met him, and I was very impressed. And, you know, I'd been practicing law 30-something years by that time, so it's not exactly like I said, oh, yeah, this guy's innocent, I gotta do it. We did our due diligence. I got to know Eric better and better, and did my own investigation and realized that what he was saying was absolutely right. And but I knew that Eric had exhausted all of his appeals. He had been to federal court, habeas corpus, once or twice.
Twice,
been turned down by a federal judge. In fact, now we're before the same federal judge
who denied
his habeas corpus. We now have a civil case, and this judge is mediating or attempting to mediate a settlement at some point. But since I'm a corporate lawyer and really never did this type of criminal work, although I had done other types of white-collar criminal stuff, I figured I could do no harm because he had already exhausted all of his appeals. All of the real criminal lawyers had already turned you down.
Yes.
So I said to Eric, look, let's work together on this, but you have to understand, given where this case is, we're really looking for the one-armed man. The only way we're going to get you out of prison realistically is if we can find the real killers. And that was our quest. For 6 years, Eric and I worked together, mostly Eric writing letters, coming up with almost every day, Eric was calling with a new idea or something else to look into while he was in prison. And my secretary, Charmaine, really became his sidekick. He would call us with an idea and we would look into it. Some of them were really crazy. Some of them were better than that. And eventually one of Eric's letters landed on the right desk, and the rest is history.
But the key, and I'm sorry if I offended you with my question, it was badly worded.
People are always trying to offend lawyers, but I think we do a very good job.
Yeah. Journalists as well. The key was, no offense to Eric, was not his character so much, was it, as it was the research that he brought to you. Is that true?
Well,
that there was information that he had that was
No, no, actually it was... Because we didn't have that information. All I had was Eric's strong conviction that he was innocent, and my read on him was that he was telling the truth. Now, of course, while I believe that he was telling the truth, you're always a little bit skeptical in dealing with any client, because any client, even in a civil case, their idea of what is actually true may not be, you know, exactly what someone on the other side is going to think is true. So, but I dug into the case and I realized that this woman couldn't possibly be telling the truth. That's when it really became a quest.
So, if we
to
think
try
about
to find the real killers,
if we think about sort of the verification of your account and the verification of what actually happened, you had documentary evidence in the form of the cell phone records.
That we got much later.
But you got much later. You had some point did some what I call ground truthing. You went and said there's no freaking way she could see that from here.
We did what the police should have done. We went to the apartment. We went with a video camera, and we filmed what you could see from there. And it was very clear, if you looked at all the evidence that the police had, that the shooting occurred. It was more than a few, although this video says a couple of car lengths, it was more like 300 yards from where she said she saw it happen. And it just was impossible. And then if you take the time of year and how cold it would be in January, she's supposedly out there looking out her window and hearing all this stuff occurring, you know, hundreds of yards away from where she actually was. It was just,
so, I mean, you were looking at as close as you could get to direct physical evidence.
Yeah, you know, we were on the scene. Right.
On the scene, you're mm-hmm. taking pictures, you're yeah. documenting it. When you went to the producers above you, what were the drivers? What was it that made this story something that they said, yeah, that's, they get a lot of pitches, right? I mean, what's the ratio of rejected pitches to accepted pitches?
This is being recorded, right?
Yeah, I mean, like, what was the selling point? What convinced them?
Eric, you know, it's a challenging thing with these stories, because very often, if somebody is in prison and is actually innocent, you know, Dateline is not the innocent show. Usually it's a husband killing a wife or a wife killing her husband. That's really our show. And so we're a murder mystery show. And I fortunately, I mean, I, you know, there's other things that we do sometimes. And this was a story that was important to me. And very often with these types of stories, it's very difficult, because there's what I'll call a certain emotional access that the audience needs to really plug in and care about the guy behind bars.
They've got to sympathize with somebody.
And frankly, that's why you met Grandma, Sister Chan, before you met Eric in the story. Because I started filming Eric when he was still a convicted murderer behind bars. I'm sure there's a lot of producers who go to their bosses and say, there's an innocent guy in prison or whatever. Yeah, okay, sure. You know, and just the thought of it, not saying they disbelieve it, but anybody knows that it's a major, major expedition to get to the bottom of these stories, and particularly if a man is still in prison, a jury has spoken, and that's a pretty strong statement, and it's gotten through the criminal justice system. So, you know, with Eric's story, it was really Eric, and I don't really know what sold it, but sometimes these are difficult to do.
So the interesting thing listening to you talk, Eric, is that it seems to me, and I haven't known you all that long, that you've made a great deal of use of the things you've learned in school. You're talking about coming out, and it's almost like you were a social scientist coming into this strange culture. You talked about subcultures and cultural ways.
Yeah.
I guess the thing that I'm interested in about from each of you.
What happened was, when I got out, 2 days later, I was back enrolled in college. So I didn't have a chance for anything. I was looking for normalcy, because every day I was in school, so I needed school. I rode the train a lot, and I just observed. I observed everybody. I observed everybody's demeanor, their interaction with each other.
What are some of the things that you remember? Some of the things that were different.
Yeah, there was major differences.
Like about society today.
Like, you know, I seen that everybody was just in tune with these cell phones, or either with a nuke or some electronic reader. But the thing that really hurt me the most that I was drawn towards was that everyone out here has become an individual. There's no more sense of community anymore. Like, people come together collectively as like a human race. Like when I was home, everybody has their own things that they're doing, and I noticed more that people are just working today just to maintain their poverty. So that doesn't give them any room for leisure or interaction or socializing or anything. It's just get up in the morning, go to work, come home, eat, feed your kids or whatever, you know, do some extracurricular stuff, and then back to bed, and the next day is repetitive. It's the same thing. But I want to change that. So I spoke with my attorney, you know. I really want to go to law school. I don't have the time for it right now, but I really do want to go to law school. I don't want to major in criminal law or anything. But I want a law degree because I want to run for public office. That's my goal. And I'm going to do it one day, believe me. Because if I'm in public office and I become a legislator or something of that nature, I'm the representative of this district, I can control the money that comes in there into that community, that district. And I know exactly where it needs to be. And I need more jobs and more after-school programs and, you know, things that'll give people a chance to breathe a little in life. You know, extra, like, after-school programs for kids that are, how would you say it, are effective. Because the programs that they have today are just designed just to keep your kid after school until a certain time and release them. There's no real curriculum in these after-school programs, because I've spoken at least like 3 schools, and I asked the principal, and I actually went and I observed the after-school programs, and it's just a bunch of kids just sitting around. There's no reading no more. Kids don't even know about books anymore. Everything is on a cell phone. But I think that if I'm able to control the money that's coming into the community, I will be able to make a bigger difference and change people's lives.
What was your question?
So I was heading another direction. I mean, now we've got your announcement that you're running for office. We've committed some news tonight, so that's actually pretty interesting. I guess what I wanted each of you to reflect on for a second, and then we'll go to the questions, so start preparing for your question. What is the ability of information to equalize power? You were in a powerless place. How important was information, and what kind of information actually serves as an equalizer?
The truth. That's the kind of information that's the equalizer, is the truth. And that's all you're looking for in there. When you're sentenced to 25 years to life and you see other individuals who have been in there for 34 years, 40 years, and constantly being denied by parole, and you see people die in there, and I've seen people commit suicide, you wonder, is that going to be your fate? Are you going to die in prison? Will that be you, the guy that down the few cells away that just hung himself because he got tired of getting hit by parole? When you go to the parole board in there, they always constantly give you 2 extra years. You can do 25 years, but when you go to parole board, they hit you with 2 more years, so you're doing 27 years. And when you go back to the parole board, they give you another 2 more years, so you're doing 29 years. And it's just a constant thing.
Peter.
Well,
it's scary. It's very scary. So you're looking for the truth. You want to get out of there, so you're going to fight.
Well, in our case, what really, I think, helped to make a difference was the fact that we had Dan and Dateline behind us. There are so many people that Dan and I have come across, and Dan has been doing this longer than I have. Dan's been doing it for about 20 years. I've only been in this now for about 8 years. But there, we all know of many innocent people. And it's one thing to have the knowledge that they're innocent, another thing to be able to turn the system around. That's a very hard thing to do. And the press and coverage like Dan was willing to provide through NBC was critical in getting our case not only public attention, but getting the district attorney to really focus on this and realize that something had to be done about Eric's case. And in fact, I don't think it would have been possible to get Eric and the four other people out of jail in the time that we were able to do it, a reasonable amount of time, but for the fact that the press was really on our side. I'm not going to say on our side. The press was out there for the facts, but the facts were on our side, and so that really put the press on our side. We had the New York Times, the New York Post, all the local papers supporting the cause of Eric's innocence.
I actually think that this one point is a very interesting discussion for a journalism school, because I'm often accused, I'll use the word accused, of being an advocate. And in terms of your question about information wins the day in our world, right? As journalism, it's the facts that rule the day, not emotion. It's not, you know, either we have the facts to stand to report a story, broadcast a story with some serious allegations, and they're the facts, or we don't have them. So that wins the day. And we need to do that in an objective, fair-minded, intellectually honest way. The problem with these kinds of cases is that your head and your heart start to get, you know, talking to each other. And when you walk into a maximum security prison, or when I'm in Sing Sing and I'm looking at Eric in his cell, and I know the facts, that becomes something that I feel like I can't turn away from as a human being. And so what I need to evaluate very often, and I do it all the time, is think to myself, am I going too far? Is this the right thing to be doing as a journalist? Is this the right thing to be doing as a human being? And when do I care or not? And what I mean by that is, I felt, for example, when Eric was still in prison, I felt like a story had to be done. To me, it wasn't advocacy. It was an important story. So I pushed and produced a story that aired on WNBC while Eric was still in prison on Channel 4, which raised awareness about the case. Was that a move of advocacy? Peter says, on our side. I had nobody telling me that Eric was guilty. So I don't know if it's about a side or it's an interesting debate, and one that, you know, when we're involved with matters of the heart in journalism, you have to reevaluate it a lot and make sure you're not crossing the line. Because once you do, there's really A, no going back, and B, your entire product becomes questionable.
Okay, we're going to turn to your questions. If you'd line up at the microphone. The microphone's here and here, and we'll take turns back and forth. I need you to line up quickly so we can do a little time count, because we have a thing called the Bernstein rule, which is that the people answering the questions have to try and cover as many of the questions as possible. So we've got 8, 10, 12. Ooh, we've got about... I'm going to say we've got 15 questions for 15 minutes, so this is going to be like a lightning round, gentlemen. If you would identify yourself quickly and say who the question is directed to, and away we go. So we'll start here.
Hi, I'm Ariel Mendelson. I have a question for Eric.
Yes.
So in general, when people go to jail for when they're innocent, they get like a stipend at the end or something. I was wondering what you got when
a
you
stipend?
Got released. Yeah.
He didn't even
like,
get a bus ticket.
It's not the word for, you know, like money back.
Well, you know, when you're released and you file civil suits, the state and the city, you know, at some point they compensate you. And I don't really know exactly what's going on, but my attorney can...
I didn't know if maybe they paid for college for you or
no. Let me say something about this, because this really bothers the heck out of me. If you serve your time in prison, they have all sorts of release programs for prisoners who actually were guilty and served their time. When Eric and other people like him get out of jail, that's it. they have, there is no program for any person who was wrongfully convicted and is released from jail.
No resources.
We were very lucky that the same Mercy College scholarship program that normally doesn't extend to released prisoners, what, they made an exception for Eric, and they, Mercy College and the Sunshine Lady Foundation each split half the cost of the rest of Eric's college education.
Okay.
But there's nothing provided for
Mercy's expensive.
Yeah.
Very expensive.
Sorry.
And they call themselves Mercy.
You should have gone to Stony Brook, Eric.
Yeah. Hello, Mr. Glisson. My name is Jonathan Klein. So my question is, why was it that the prostitute named you and the five other people that were put away?
Well, at the time, she was homeless, and the police gave her opportunity to gain housing as well as some subsidized income with welfare and things of that nature in exchange for her testimony.
Dane?
You watch the whole show. You'll see it.
Dane?
Hi, my name is Dan Taylor. I'm just wondering, why aren't you angry? Because that...
Well, if I was to remain angry and keep that bitterness inside me, it'll start to fester, and it'll start to hurt me as well as the people around me. And I've never been one that holds a grudge against anybody. Yeah, I may dislike what the detectives did to me. I may say F them or whatever. People ask me, people said that they should be in prison, but I don't agree with that. I just want to be happy. You know, I'm not the one that have to look in the mirror. It's them. They're the one that committed this injustice against me, and they have to look at themselves every day, not me.
Hi, my name is Mirna, and I have two questions.
You don't get two, you just get one. Nice try, though.
I answered them fast.
Question.
Okay. Did any family members or friends actually believe that you were guilty?
Well, a lot of my family members abandoned me while I was in there, which hurt a lot. But since then, I forgave them. And you know, I still keep contact with them. Like one of my aunts, because in there, you get to cook. You get to cook inside your cell and make all the food you want. You have pots and pans. And there was quite a few nights that I went to bed hungry, you know, with no food in my cell, and I would call home to ask one of my aunts or something for something to eat, to send me something fast to eat, and she would tell me, don't the state supposed to take care of you? Mm-hmm. And, you know, that hurt, but I still talk to her today, and I forgave her for that. So, you know, never hold a grudge, because if you go to sleep with a grudge and that anger in your heart, you're going to wake up mean and mad the next morning.
Since he took mercy on you, you get number two.
Okay. Are you trying to do anything to help other innocent prisoners?
Well, right now, mm-hmm. you know, things are in, like, it's just like planning stages. But I do plan to come up with a foundation that is going to be interested in helping other people gain their freedom and exonerate actually innocent people.
Thanks.
We're going to need a lot of journalists for that.
Hello, my name is Giovanni. And when you came back from prison, how did you see your neighborhood? And in what ways do you feel that it has changed, specifically your neighborhood? Like
my neighborhood? My neighborhood took a turn for the worse. Is gang infested now. A lot of people who lived there, decent people back then, have moved out. I don't frequent it anymore. So I really don't know much about what's going on there. You know, my life is structured now. I just have things that I do every day. Repetitive, like working my store and working the daytime. I I build buildings. I'm building a five-story building right now because I love construction for affordable homes. And later on at night, I work at my juice bar and I help out. So that's basically my typical day.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Hi, my name's Stephanie. I'm a little short. I have a question for Eric. When you were in jail, did you meet others that also were wrongfully convicted? And if so, could you say one of their stories that moved you the most and if they ever got out?
Well, there's a show that was aired by NBC that Dan spoke about. It's called Conviction. And it's a dear friend of mine, an actual comrade. His name is John Adrian Velasquez. So if any of y'all Google his name, John Adrian Velasquez, you will see his story. And, you know, I'm just so sad that I left my comrade back there, knowing that he's innocent. But we're working to get him released. It's going to be an uphill battle because, you know, the district attorney's office is reluctant to admit that he's innocent. But if any of y'all are willing, you can just pray for him and just keep a good spirit and just hope that he's released soon. Because I spoke with him about a week and a half ago, and I could tell, like, he's losing his spirit. You can tell that he's losing that fight, and I just want to just send positive energy towards him so that he can keep that spirit up and continue fighting.
Okay, great. Thank you.
So John Adrian Velasquez. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Jason. I have a question for Eric. So earlier someone asked if you met the two detectives that sent you into prison, and you said that there was a lot of legal processes that are still occurring for this case. I was wondering what kind of legal processes are still occurring, even though I thought it ended right there, as you mentioned.
Well, there's still a lot of investigation going on by the state and the city. They're trying to defend this case and possibly put me back in prison.
What?
Because they're asking questions about, you know, they're asking about whether I was really involved in this case. They're still asking this question to themselves. And I know I'm innocent. They know I'm innocent. And they have the two guys who did it. So I'll always be free. So there's nothing that can be done.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Saish, and my question is to Eric. How did you trace the call history of the victim who was like 20 calls made 20 years ago while you were still in the prison? Like,
can you repeat that?
How did you get the call history of the person, the victim, while you were still in prison? Like, how did you trace the calls, like the call history of the person?
The victim?
Yeah.
How
the
did
taxi
I
driver, what? Yeah. How did you get the call history, the cell phone history?
Oh, the cell phone records?
Yeah.
Oh, through freedom of information.
Okay.
The core history, right?
Uh-huh.
Well, when they committed this crime, they took the victim's cell phone, and that was part of the indictment. But the district attorney and the police, they had that information from the beginning.
So 20 years back, it wasn't noted.
They never investigated. They had it from maybe 3 weeks after I was incarcerated. They had the victim's cell phone records, and they had an itemized list of everyone who was called with that phone, but they refused to investigate it.
Well, actually, they did. We know they did investigate it, and in fact, the first call that was made a few minutes after the killing was to the home of
the
one
father.
Of the actual killers.
The father.
I mean,
who confessed?
Who had confessed to the feds in 2002? So, if the police had done any kind of normal police work, they would have found the real killers. By using the cell phone records. That's what makes this case very egregious, besides a lot of other stuff that went wrong.
Yeah.
Well, the I think part of what he's asking is how did he get those records? Under state law.
Get them.
Under state law, everyone in this room has the right to request copies of police investigative records after a period of time and could have done what Eric did. Every one of you has the right to see those files.
Yes. Okay. From any government agency, you can. It's called Freedom of Information. You know, it's an acronym. The acronym is FOIL, F-O-I-L. So whatever document that you want, you can just request it through a Freedom of Information request, and they make you pay 25 cents a page.
Okay.
Yeah, and so when you see those documents, everything that's useful is blacked out, right?
Yeah, it's always omitted. So a lot of times when I got those documents, I was down because what I was looking for was blotted out.
Oh, okay. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Hello, my name's Nicola. I was wondering, and this is for, I guess, anyone, what's the first change that you would like to see in the justice system to avoid this same thing happening to other people?
I want to see the indemnification removed from the district attorney. You know, they're indemnified and basically exempt from any prosecution. Well, they have blanket immunity. So they can arrest anybody, know that they're innocent, and still continue to prosecute them and convict them and send them away for the rest of their life and not be held accountable for it.
I feel like this is a really nuanced, it's a good question. I think it's a really nuanced answer because, you know, with these cases, there's really never a bad person, so to speak, because that's the bad guy, because it's more bureaucratic. It's more kind of, that's the way the system works. Prosecutors put people in prison, defense attorneys try and get them out of prison. And I think that, you know, without pointing to, I mean, there's certain things that have been suggested for years, which, you know, sequential lineups, not the detective not overseeing the case, not doing the lineup, so it's blind, so that the person conducting lineups doesn't know who the people are in for eyewitness identification, videotaping confessions. There's all those specific suggestions how to strengthen the system. But what I think overall, and smarter people disagree maybe with me, is that there needs to be an independent, intellectually honest, objective group of people who can review these cases. Because generally what happens, as in John Adrian Velasquez's case, again, that's John Adrian Velasquez, V-E-L-A-Z-Q-U-E-Z. If you see his show that we did, that's the one I took 10 years to investigate, you'll see that 99 out of 100 people will say he's innocent, and the one other person might say, well, he didn't get a fair trial. But the problem, as I see it with his case, is that the Manhattan District Attorney's Office, who are the ones who got the conviction, are the ones doing the reinvestigation. And there's an inherent conflict in that, whether you know it or not, sociologically. In other words, if someone said to me, with even what I know about wrongful convictions, if someone said to me today, you're now the DA of Manhattan County, I can't be intellectually honest and tell you that I would behave differently because I don't know the pressure of the bureaucracy underneath me.
Footnote to news literacy students, verification, independence, accountability. Right, that district attorney who put him away cannot be independent in his investigation of whether they put him away incorrectly. You can use that on the exam tomorrow, by the way.
Well, the district attorney who arrested me, he met his own fate. He had a massive heart attack in court during another murder trial. So, you know, he's no longer with us, and, you know, I grieve for his family, you know, because they're suffering without their loved one, and they're not the ones who committed this against me. But, you know, I guess he got what he deserved.
Okay, I think we've got room for two more, so you're up, man.
No, we got my name is Alex, and I have a question for Eric.
What's up?
We heard pretty much a lot of story what happened to you after, and what did you do to fight against? What happened that night? Like, what were you doing at that moment? Can you describe us a little in detail?
Well, the crime happened at, I think it was 4 o'clock in the morning. I was asleep. I was at home sleeping. You know, I wasn't arrested until two and a half weeks after. And I just had my daughter. I watched her come out. I was there in the hospital. I seen all of this. I got to spend 2 weeks with her, and then I was just taken away. You know, so you know that had to be one of the most darkest times in my life.
So this lady who accused you, she had no reason to believe that that was you? She just met
Eric had a sexual relationship with her? With the witness?
A one-night stand?
Is that what you're asking about,
no.
The main witness?
Oh, no, 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 no. I'm sorry, not being... No, no, no. The lady who saw through her window...
Yes, the main witness, yes. Eric had a relationship with her.
Okay.
And that's how... And it ended badly, and she knew the other people. It's a small neighborhood where he lived in the Soundview section of the South Bronx. And it was a tight-knit neighborhood, and everybody knew each other.
Okay.
And she had some sort of personal beef, if you will. Which she admitted during the trial. Yeah.
Well, she said she hated me. She hoped that I died, that she had a new boyfriend, and thank God he looks better than me.
That was all in testimony.
Yeah, it was her testimony.
She's also
and no one even objected, right? But did you look better than you?
Okay, last
Thank
question.
You. Hi, my name is Kyle Barr. My question is for Eric and Mr. Cross. Why do you feel, whether psychologically or legally, that the government or district attorney had so much of a problem with admitting any wrongdoing on this part of the case?
Why do I feel they had a problem admitting any wrongdoing?
Yeah, they haven't.
They've never admitted any wrongdoing. Even when they released Eric from prison, the day that we were in court, they refused. No one said, we're sorry we made a mistake to Eric. In fact, they just said we're compelled to release him, basically because we proved he was innocent. This is just a fact of the system. DAs, they exist basically to prosecute people, and they don't like to give up those prosecutions. One of the reasons Sean Adrian is still in jail, even though we all know he's innocent, is that the DA who tried the case against him is still part of the Manhattan District Attorney's Office. I'm shocked that they're keeping this man in jail. We all know he's innocent.
Well, I did get a little bit of relief. Because for 16 years, there was a woman named Nancy Killian who worked in the Bronx District Attorney's Office on the Appeals Bureau. She was the one who would file the opposition against every appeal that I've submitted to the court. So she was like my long-term nemesis. At every turn, it was her name, Nancy Killian, Nancy Killian, Nancy Killian. Every time I filed an appeal, she would object to it, file an opposition. She would lie throughout her content in the appeal, and it would get rejected. But I got to meet her in that courtroom that day, and I walked up to her and I said, "Mrs. Killian, it's finally nice to meet you." I said, "You won a lot of battles, but I just won the war." She put her head down in defeat, and I just looked at her and I walked off. You know, that was like my crowning moment. I got a chance to see her put her head down in defeat, because every document I have has her name on it.
He called. He got out with an ankle bracelet. I told you that they made him for 3 months.
Oh,
yeah, tell him.
Oh, I had left from the hotel, then I went and I was living in the village. Mr. Cross' assistant Miss Charmaine had helped me get an apartment with some church people in the neighborhood in the village on Christopher and Bleecker. And I was living in this one bedroom apartment, and I had this ankle monitor on, and then Hurricane Sandy hit. And the lights went out. And you have to charge this thing. Like, you know, they put this on me to add insult to injury, you know. And it started beeping and vibrating at like about 2 something at night. And I was scared to death. I called Peter and he told me, don't worry about it, call Charmaine, who lived around the corner. And me and Charmaine wound up being in the precinct. until about 4 o'clock in the morning, charging my leg. So, you know, that was the most embarrassed thing that happened to me. And the priest in charging my leg.
So, ladies and gentlemen, I want you to join me in thanking Eric and Dan and Peter and wishing them well.